Hello, summoners, and welcome to the first ever official Marvel Contest of Champions live stream here on twitch.tv/kabam. My name is Jax, one of your community managers, and I'm thrilled to be coming to you live from Kabam Studios here in sunny Vancouver on this beautiful Wednesday, January 18th. We have a fantastic show planned for you guys today with a lot of sneak peeks behind the scenes at our upcoming content, Eternity of Pain Acceptance. We have a lot to get through today, and I'm thrilled for every single moment of it. We've got talks with the senior quest designer responsible for Acceptance. We're gonna chat with a little content creator spotlight and bring on Legacy. And we're gonna do a little segment of MCOC for Beginners. But first, I wanted to say hello to each and every one of you, and thank you so much for being here. We have the chat running here. I'm seeing Captain 007. We've got Solitaire X. We've got lots of hard names to pronounce. But Luke the Man is here. Mr. King, Twitchy D, great to see everybody. Thank you so much. Everyone say hey in chat, and welcome, welcome, welcome. So as we talked about, this is the first ever official Marvel Contest of Champions live stream. This is something that we want to start doing on a monthly basis, and if there's cause for it, maybe twice a month. It's something that we see as a very valuable tool for engaging with you guys in the community, being able to communicate information to you in a timely manner, and honestly, just kind of having fun here with the community. The intention is we want to give you guys a sneak peek. We want to communicate and we want to increase transparency. But that always comes with a bit of an asterisk in the sense that we can't tell you everything all of the time. So let's go over some ground rules here. This is a positive environment that we're trying to set here. The chat is being heavily moderated. Please don't be a fool. That's it. It's simple. This is how you would treat your family. Not just your family, your parents and your grandparents. Let's treat everybody with respect here, maybe just a little bit of love, and let's keep things cordial and fun. And I think we're all gonna have a good time that way. We do have a number of moderators in chat that are keeping an eye on things, but that being said, we also will have opportunities for question and answer segments throughout the show. So if you have any questions, feel free to throw them in the chat. We're gonna have our moderators keep an eye out and at certain points throughout the show have an opportunity to pop in and give a little insight to the questions that you guys might have. So again, throw those in the chat. But that being said, we're not gonna be able to get every single question, unfortunately. Keep an eye out on the forums. I'm in there, Mike is in there, we have a number of our moderators in there every single day, trying to answer as many questions as we can with the most important information getting to as many people as possible. So hop on in there. We also, leading up to this stream, had an opportunity for you guys to throw in some questions to be answered on this stream as well. So that's something that we'll look to continue to do in future. So we are live in Kabam Studios here. We've built out our own set, our own studio space. And if everything goes well, who knows, maybe we'll move to an even bigger space, but I'm thrilled to have you guys here. I said it was sunny Vancouver and I have to come clean. It's raining and miserable here, but I just wanted to start on a really positive note, you know? Cool. I know you guys are all here for a reason. Before we even started the stream, we saw the chat going off and I love, love, love the punctuation that everybody showed up with. And also, you know what? Some reliability, because the number of people I saw say, what are the rewards, was a lot. There was a lot of you. But it's great to see some more familiar faces. One more shout out before we dive into everything. We've got Xander. Great to see you here. I saw Devin. Drew says Jax is a really nice dude. Thanks. Where's Dorky? Antonio? He's here. He's here. Don't worry. He's just behind the scenes right now. It's something, again, as we start to build up this stream and cover different content, we will have kind of different opportunities to communicate different things and maybe take some inspiration from the audience. If you guys want to see specific conversations or learn about specific things within the game and the development process, that's something that we can explore. So I don't want to say we'd have Dave on right away, but I wouldn't mind, you know? He is a good dude. We sit across from each other. Most people wouldn't put that together. All right, but let's dive into the reason that we have everyone here. EOP, let's talk about it. Welcome to your final step in your Eternity of Pain journey, Acceptance. You've handled denial, anger, bargaining, depression, and now your reward is more pain. Alongside acceptance, we are also introducing Karina's Challenges Volume 3 with 4 objectives for TB players, 2 additional objectives for Paragon players, and 1 final objective for Paragons to clear all of the 6 previous objectives. Let's bring the person who is responsible for fleshing out Eternity of Pain acceptance to the show here. Everybody in chat, please help me welcome to the show, Kevin. Thanks for being here, friend. How are you?
Thanks for having me, Jackson. I'm doing good.
Good. Great to hear it. And thank you for sitting through my very long-winded intro. You're an absolute saint. Okay, let's dive into some questions. Let's get to know you just a little bit here. So you are a senior quest designer.
Yeah.
How long have you been working at Kabam? And what were you doing to kind of work your way into senior quest designer territory?
So I've been here for about 3 years. I think literally 3 years in February. And so before that, I worked at a couple of small indie studios, and then my first like big, I guess, job was working at the Coalition, which makes Gears of War. So I was there for a little bit. I actually, when I got the job there, it was between an offer for here and an offer for there. I decided to go with that offer at the time, but I ended up here anyway.
Nice.
Yeah.
Kabam's inevitable. You will inevitably end up here, right?
Yeah.
All right, tell us a little bit about your desire to be in game design. What sparked it, and what was that process like throughout kind of growing up, going to school with this in mind? What was that whole process like?
Sure. So I think what sparked it was my dad had his friend over, and he brought his SNES. So this was like way back for some people in chat, I guess. but yeah, he brought it over, and it had A Link to the Past on it. And I've been watching them playing it, and they'd seen how interested I was, so they let me like play it for a bit. And he saw I enjoyed it so much that he actually gave me the SNES and like left it there.
Awesome.
So I played A Link to the Past a ton, and that kind of grew into me as I played games, like asking questions like why they did certain things in the game and trying to figure out basically how they had put stuff together. Even if I like felt like this was bad game design or something, I tried to like break it down in my mind. And that kind of just carried over throughout school and into designing games myself, starting with like smaller like modding projects and stuff and then getting into actual like dev work.
Nice. So when you were young, and kind of, it seems like you had this goal in mind from very young.
Yes.
When you were kind of growing up, were you very young just like creating games, and would you play games with friends that you kind of started to put together on your own?
Yeah, I think like, you know, like schoolyard games, obviously kind of stuff, but also like stuff with like pen and paper or like even like action figures and stuff like that is where I started. Like getting into digital or technical stuff probably didn't come until high school. And even then, like it's, you kind of have to dive into a lot of that yourself. Who knows? It might have changed these days. But yeah, back then, you had to kind of dive into it yourself a lot because there wasn't a lot of like avenues straight up from school and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I see a lot of times people that are curious, and I have the conversations occasionally about people that love games and are passionate about games, and like, how do I get into games? And from what I've learned in my short time here, it's you got to start putting in the legwork, right?
Yes.
Like school is always an option, but you have to be passionate, motivated, and like what other type of advice would you give someone who's like, I really love games and I want to get into them?
I would say you want to probably find like a local, there's usually like a local community that has like a game jam meetup or something like that to talk about stuff. Like you said, schools, it can be a decent avenue. Generally, you're not going to go the normal approach. A lot of people go to like, for here specifically, Vancouver Film School, which is like a shortened like 2-year program that's really focused on it. And then a lot of it otherwise is kind of like industry connection stuff in a way. It's a lot of putting your name out there and like marketing yourself really. And then, I mean, the other thing I'd say, which I still think is pretty big these days, is getting to work on like modding games.
Yeah.
Doing game mod stuff, whether it's like Gary's Mod or, you know, Elder Scrolls or other stuff like that, which are all the big ones, is kind of a way to get your toes in the water in regards to game dev.
Yeah, and kind of build out a portfolio of work, right? You want people to be able to see, not only are you passionate and motivated, but you can do it, right? You don't wait for the opportunity to be handed to you to prove that you can do it. Prove it to earn those opportunities.
Yep.
All right, now done with the philosophy of game design portion of the stream.
You could keep me talking for like an hour.
Right? It's a really exciting thing, which I love, you know? Let's, before we dive into full-on acceptance here, another important thing happening in-game right now, who are you voting for in Summoner's Choice?
So I actually split my votes between Bullseye and Marrow. Marrow because the first time I saw Marrow was in MVC 2, Marvel vs. Capcom 2.
Yeah.
She's a fighting game.
Yeah.
She's pretty terrible in it, but she was one of those like offshoot Marvel characters. Mm-hmm. And Bullseye, just because I've read a lot of like OG like Daredevil, Punisher comics, and I think there's something interesting just about a dude whose ability is I can shoot really good. I just have pinpoint accuracy with everything I use or throw.
Yeah, I think that's a desirable trait for almost anyone who plays video games, right? Okay, let's get right into it here. We're going to talk about EOP acceptance. We're going to dive into some of the guiding philosophies and behind-the-scenes peaks here, and then we're going to talk Karina's challenges. Yep. But when you're developing content similar to EOP or EOP explicitly, it's very challenging. It's very over the top. It's very exciting for the community. What is something that you kind of hold in back of mind as a guiding philosophy? What's your intention? What are you trying to accomplish? What spurs you along this path?
So for EOP, the main design philosophy for a lot of the fights was find like unused parts of champions' kits or really like lesser known parts of champions' kits. The basic example is the Warlock fight, where a lot of people didn't know that when Warlock has an armor up, he cannot be hit by guaranteed crits. So a lot of people went into that fight and thought that it was broken or bugged or some other stuff like that. So a bunch of the fights are based on that. Other ones are just trying to find like a core loop off of like a node idea for like a buff node or stuff like that. Like the Bishop fight was kind of around, well, Bishop's like a strong defender. And then how else can I build on that with the whole like energy actuator stuff and the power bar manipulation? And then others can be based off of fights we've done in the past and just modifying them. So the Crossbones one is, you know, loosely based off of Act 6 Crossbones pre-nerf. and then kind of juicing some of that stuff up a bit. You guys would have hated if he had Vigor on it instead of when we went with the Vital Strikes.
Yeah, and I gotta say a personal thank you to you from the community team for making people think stuff's broken so that they come to the forums and let us know. And we're like, no, it's not broken. Don't worry about it just yet. Speaking of, come hang out in the forums, gang. We'll see if we can get a link dropped in chat for you. You guys can come hang out there. There's a lot of good people there. And let's just bring some positivity to my day-to-day life. I'd appreciate it. Thanks. All right. So how does this version of EOP differ from previous entries? What are people expecting to see? No one's seen this yet.
Yes.
Kind of lay it out for us in a visual perspective.
All right, so basically we're taking all 16 of the previous fights, as you know, and we're putting them into one map. So there's two paths. Each path has 8 fights. At the end of that path is the Nameless Thanos boss. Halfway through each one of those paths, so after 4 fights, you're gonna get a choice node, just because we're being nice, where you can swap out one champion on your team. The downside in that regard is that your team is still 3 champions. So 3 champions for 9 fights, you get one choice node. And you've got those two paths. And then we've got the additional second quest, which is one path, all 16 fights, plus the Nameless Thanos boss at the end. Still 3 champions, no choice node. And you get something special for that, which I think we're going over later.
Yeah, let's just dive into it now. Who cares about the order of show when I'm excited as I am about this? So if you tackle all 16 bosses in a row, and then take down Nameless Thanos, you're gonna get a Nameless Thanos profile picture.
Yes.
So I think it's exceptional because if I'm going to matchmake into any Battlegrounds match and see that, I'll probably just leave. I know the kind of caliber people I'm dealing with at that point in time, and I might just nope out.
Understandable.
Yeah. All right, we have now pulled up our Eternity of Pain acceptance slideshow. And we're going to talk about the Karina's challenges and rewards throughout here. So let's dive right in. We're going to take a look at the completion and exploration rewards here. So some pretty simple stuff here. But what kind of stands out to you as maybe some of the juicier rewards that people might be excited about here?
I think the 3-4 rank up gem is always going to be good.
Yeah.
I know people had a lot of rank ups recently with the whole banquet and stuff, but I think you can never have too many rank up gems, especially 3-4.
You can never have too many rank up gems. You heard it here first. We're going to put it on a shirt. Find it in the Kabam merch store soon. No, it's absolutely true. Myself and the banquet as well earned way more 6-stars and way more rank up gems than I ever have in my life. And we've talked about it a little bit within the community about people kind of coming down from the banquet, and now it just feels maybe a little bit slower, which is reasonable. It's just at a normal pace now, but to see that 3-4 rank up gem on that exploration is a pretty solid little perk for you there. Okay, let's dive into some of Karina's challenges 3.0. So I saw a question in chat earlier asking about if they are completely tied to this event, And they are.
Yes.
All of these Karina's challenges are locked into EOP acceptance. I know previously we had them tied to the Grandmaster Gauntlet and a handful of other things as well. But these ones are completely locked in to acceptance, so prepare yourselves. All right, looking at the first two Thronebreaker challenges here, it's gonna be completing acceptance with specifically tag champs. Yep. We're looking at a robot tag and a dimensional being tags, full rosters. And then we've got the rewards off to the side here, another six-star class Nexus Crystal, and a handful of rank-up stuff, and just a cool mill on the gold line, which you like to see as well. Who do you anticipate being the MVPs of robots and dimensional being tag champs here?
So for robot, I expect to see a bunch of Dragon Man, because he's like the robot that's not in tech, so
okay.
People are probably going to have to bring him for a lot of stuff. And you'll probably see Warlock a decent bit, maybe Omega Sentinel, maybe Nimrod. For Dimensional Being, I'm probably going to see Hood a decent amount, I'd imagine, and I'd also expect people who have him to bring in Galen for some of those fights.
Yeah, and I'm glad that you said that, because I just pulled six-star Dragon Man during the Banquet
nice.
Event. So. Do I think I'm ready for this? Not even a little bit, but it's nice to know that when I get there, I might have a leg up.
No.
Okay, let's throw over to the next page here and two more Thronebreaker Karina's challenges and a different set of rewards. Again, these rewards are rewarded twice, one for each objective.
Yep.
That is not a total rewards, important to mention here. For these two Thronebreaker quests, we have Thunderbolts and Brotherhood of Mutants. I'm a big mutant fan. I've built a lot of my roster around mutants. But let's break it down. I know we just updated the Thunderbolts tag.
Yes.
I saw a lot of people asking why. This is why we did that. But again, lots of new excitement from Thunderbolts. Anyone that you expect to stand out as being a big help in progressing through this one?
So I think Crossbones is probably somebody we're going to see a fair bit for Thunderbolts. And then I'd also expect like Red Hulk probably to pop up as a workhorse. So that's, you know, an OG Thunderbolt for people to use.
Good.
Yeah. And then for Mutants, I think you're going to see House of X a lot over Red Megs, honestly, due to
Ooh.
Like pre-fights and passive stun stuff. And then you're probably going to see either Scarlet Witch or Juggernaut on people's teams to get somebody outside of the mutant class on your team.
Yeah. Oh, that's sneaky.
Yeah.
I want to point out that I'm still relatively new to this game, so I'm learning more than you will learn. I understand that. You've had a 6, 7, 8 year head start on me. This is a big game, so I'm learning a lot here. And I hope you guys are too. And then we've got another set of rewards, again, rewarded twice, one for each of these. You know what? I've seen the reception from it initially here. Pretty not terrible. And you know what? I'll take that. Okay, let's dive into Paragon Karina's challenges here, tied to EOP acceptance. We've got one called Alternate Avengers for full team tagged as A-Force or Alpha Flight, and Spectacular Spiders, love an alliteration. It seems that the quest design team does, and I appreciate
oh, yeah.
that. Alliterations and puns, that we need more of them in game. Spider-Verse Hero is going to be under Spectacular Spiders. Again, this is for Paragons explicitly, so if you are a TB player, you will not have these yet.
Yes.
Earn your way into Paragon, and you're going to get more opportunities at some exciting stuff here. So Alternate Avengers, A-Force, Alpha Flight, who's your MVP? Who are you bringing in?
I expect to see She-Hulk a fair bit. Decent utility, you know, good damage. Generally been a high-level science champ for a while. And also probably Captain Marvel movie, I think we'll see a decent amount of. And then Spider-Verse, mm-hmm. Probably going to see a bunch of Spidey 2099. I think he's kind of taken over the Spider-Verse heroes is like the top pick for a lot of that class, or not a class, that tag, I'd say.
Okay.
And then also, I think you'll see Spider-Gwen, specifically for her utility in like slow and stuff coming up.
I like me some Spider-Gwen, if only for like the design. We've got a couple posters behind you there. We have a Spider-Gwen one, and I fought to put it up, but we only had limited space. That's fine. Okay, one final Karina's challenge here. We've got our Paragon basically sweep all six objectives, all six challenges. We got something exciting on the line here, and in talking to Legacy and prepping for this, we know Legacy was excited. We expect players to be excited. We have a six-star 4 to 5 rank up gem crystal. So you finish all of these challenges, likely, if you have an aligning class, likely, yes, you now have a rank 5.
Yeah, I would mostly assume that people who complete this will have one champion of every class at a 6-star rank.
I would
4,
hope so.
But, I mean, I'm sure I'll be proven wrong almost immediately.
Yeah, and don't worry, I'll know about it. They'll tell me and I'll tell you. But I think that's awesome. I think kind of seeing the way that this game's progressing and the growth of a lot of rosters, and most people might not know this, but we're actively paying attention. We are watching the content on YouTube from not only our official content creator program, but for almost anyone who's putting stuff out there, if you've got interesting stuff to share on YouTube, we're checking it out. And honestly, we love to see what you guys come up with. If it's challenges for yourselves, if it's just great gameplay, I'm learning a lot of the game from you guys. So I love the way this community just kind of feeds back into itself here. So that wraps up the Karina's challenges stuff. I know we have a couple questions coming in from chat. We'll give you guys another minute or two to kind of start to filter in a couple more and have our mods maybe pull a few. Let's do a couple more shout outs here. I see K9 and all of Brazil. All of Brazil in chat. I know you're here and I'd love to see you guys. Thank you. I saw a shout out from Turkey. Hello, everybody. Sir Williams, we see you as well. All right, a couple more questions for you. Out of 10, how difficult is this EOP acceptance going to be?
I'd probably put it at a solid 8 for like the current high level, target of the game.
Sure. Okay. And then if I wanted to do all 16 fights plus Nameless Thanos, does that make it a 10?
I mean, probably. I still fully expect to see people doing it probably first day.
Yeah.
Maybe not, who knows? But I mean, people did Abyss first day, so I would definitely expect to see it.
Yeah. You know. I talk about this frequently internally and then with some people in the community as well. With a community of our size, nothing surprise, like I've learned to not be surprised by things, because we're always like, okay, yeah, this is gonna be really challenging. We don't know, like, this is gonna take people some time, and then someone's done and we're like, yeah. Oh. There's enough people here that A, it's hard to please everyone, but B, I'm learning more and more not to be surprised by things. Yeah. All right, we got a couple questions from the chat. Gang, thank you so much for asking them, and mods, thank you for pulling them. We have Usafa, USAFA in chat, ask Kevin, how did you make this content fresh and exciting to existing players, people that may have already gone through them?
So I guess the main goal with that was really the objectives and stuff, like the completion exploration. I kind of expect you know, to bring in your Hercules or your Kitty Pryde or whatever you usually use to beat content and kind of, I don't want to say plow through it, but you know, go through it that way. The objectives are there to really like narrow down your roster choice, make you really think about who's the best counter within those tags for these fights, and stuff like that. And then, you know, the Nameless Thanos boss at the end to kind of top it off and give something extra. I'm sure, you know, everybody's fought him before. There's a bunch of different variations of Thanos. This one's different than the one in Gauntlet. So another thing to consider with your team selection.
Good, good. We're making you think, all right? We know some of you just want to cruise on through, and there's stuff for that. This isn't it, though. You're thinking in this one. We're activating brains. We love it. We got a great question here from Strong Funny Man. So is this essentially the next Abyss/Everest content?
No. I would say this is like short form Everest content. And so you had, you know, the buildup of all the EOP stuff with the individual weeks, and now we've got it all in one map, which is especially nice for people who might have missed stuff, because now it's going to be one piece of permanent content. But no, this is more what we would define as like short-term or short-form Everest content. Abyss stuff is, you know, generally longer, more grueling fight length, longer paths, stuff like that.
Cool. All right. Next question is coming in from Bully Maguire. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 9, not 7 or 8, don't forget it. Will the camera be locked and are opponents hidden?
No, camera's not locked, we're not doing that. Opponents, hiding them wouldn't really make much sense since like most of the fights are stuff you've done in the previous weeks. So that'd just be kind of like mean to players who haven't done it before. And people would just look it up anyway. No hidden stuff, no ambushes, I promise, I'm not lying. And no locked camera.
Love it, love it. Moving forward here, we got another question from Blargarden. Love the name. Would you compare the difficulty of doing one path in Abyss to doing this EOP?
I guess it's gonna kind of depend objective to objective. Maybe some of the Paragon and like some of the Thronebreaker challenges would be that in that regard of like, it's kind of pretty roster specific. So you might not be able to like attempt those objectives until you have the roster for it. It's definitely not going to take you a lot as long as an Abyss path, or at least I'd hope not. So maybe comparable. I think kind of depends on the player you are almost in a way and your roster for like whether it's easier or harder.
Awesome. And our final question coming from the chat, and again, thank you to everybody who's asked them. We're not able to get to every single one, but we love that you have inquisitive minds. Again, come check out the forums for a little bit more detail if you so seek it, and we'll be over there as well. Last one comes from, I'm just gonna spell it, C-I-K-E-N-M-C, Psyken MC, maybe. Are we gonna have more EOP form of content in the future?
I think I would love to do that, and we would love to have more of it. I can't necessarily confirm or deny that there's anything like that in the cards per se, but I think it's a type of format of content that people have definitely expressed an interest in. I think there's some ways we can improve it and tweak it, and it's fun to make.
Cool. And again, EOP acceptance is dropping in 30 minutes or so. So we hope that you guys are excited for that. Anything else that we need to get to? Is this content permanent, Hammy? Yes. I answered a question. I know some stuff. Cool. Kevin, honestly, thank you so much for coming in, for sharing some insight into everything that we're dealing with here, everything that we're excited for coming into EOP acceptance, for sharing some of your journey and everything that you've dropped on us knowledge-wise. We appreciate you, and thanks so much. Awkward handshake.
Thank you for having me, Jackson. And thank you guys.
All right, everybody, we will now be moving into a segment where we get an opportunity to talk to one of our official Marvel Contest of Champions content creators. Recently crossed over 100,000 subscribers, full-time content creator, Canadian, sweetheart, Human Torch enthusiast. We've got the one and only Legacy. Welcome to the show, dude. How are you this morning?
I'm doing fantastic. Thank you so much for having me on, Jax.
Give me just a moment here. I cannot hear you in my ear, but that's okay. We can make some adjustments on the fly. All right. Give me a little chatter, Legs. Let's see if we can hear you now.
Hey, how's it going? Can you hear me, buddy?
I can hear you. It's good to have you. Perfect. Thanks for being here, man.
Thanks for having me.
You know what? This was one of the segments I was most excited for. I would love, love, love to continue to put a spotlight on some of our content creators. We know that you guys are working really hard out there. We have a really close working relationship with our content creator program as well. We value all of the feedback that you guys give us. We try to implement and listen as much as we absolutely can. So everybody, Legacy, just over 100,000 subscribers. Hit that mark recently. You can go check out youtube.com/legacy to find all of their content. Man, walk us through it. How long have you been playing MCOC, and how long have you been full-time as an MCOC content creator?
Yeah, so it's been quite a while now. I started playing MCOC October 15th, 2016. It was a Saturday night. It was a good night. And yeah, so I started playing then. I started making some YouTube videos like Christmas of 2016, just some little crystal openings. And then after I graduated 2017, I started taking things a little bit more seriously and just tried to go for it. Took a year off school and it worked.
Yeah. You gotta love when a good gamble works like that, eh? Yeah. Congratulations on passing 100K subscribers. I've said it three times now, but I think it's a very solid number. I hope that you're happy with it. I know I would be. What do you think it is that makes your content unique? How did you get here?
I think it's a mixture of being fairly skilled at the game and somewhat entertaining, and just the combination of that makes people want to see what I'm up to.
Yeah, we've got on screen right now a little bit of B-roll from one of your on-stage competitions here. You've been going at this at a high level for a long time, and you know what? Seeing that live event makes me very, very envious. What do you think it is about MCOC that breeds the most passionate fans out there?
I think, again, a bit of a combination. First of all, you know, we have Marvel, all the big Marvel movies connected to the game. That's one of my favorite things. When you go see a new Marvel movie and then you come home and you plan those characters or you try to get them, playing the event quest, it's so much fun. I just love how all intertwined that is. And I think we've got a really good community on YouTube as well to support the game. I think that's really what's kept it going. Plus, it's a great game, of course.
Yeah, I think it's important that it's a good game, right? Yeah. That seems important.
For a mobile game, it's pretty good.
All right. So you do live streams as well as some edited YouTube content. Yep. What is the benefit to either? What kind of sets them apart, and what kind of draws you to either option?
Well, edited content is, it's good because you can get it perfectly. You know, you can do a fight 100 times and only show the one run where you play absolutely perfect and everyone thinks you're really good. you can do that, you know, and that's nice. But I prefer live streams because it's just, well, it's easier, it's more fun. I get to talk live with viewers and it's just so much fun. Plus, there's no perfect editing to make me look really good. You know, it's, you get what you get.
Yeah, that is, I mean, you get the kind of more raw, unedited version of the people that you're interacting
sure.
with. I think that's the appeal that we're trying to get here as well, doing our live streams, being able to interact with people live and have a ton of fun that way. Okay, before we switch into EOP stuff, which again is launching in less than 30 minutes here, we got to get to something really important. Who are you supporting through Summoner's Choice 2023?
Yeah, so definitely Gladiator. Gladiator gang, voting for him. He just sounds really cool. His abilities with his confidence, the more confidence he has, he's basically unstoppable. But if his confidence gets shaken, he can be taken down by Gambit. So I love the concept.
Okay. I like that as well. There's definitely a lot to build off. We love to see theory crafting as well. We love to see people be like, yeah, I support this person. But to see them take it one step further and be like, this is the kit that we think they could have. These are the elements that make them interesting that we could bring to the game. I think that's cool. Now, personally, yeah. I'm on Team Spider-Punk. And I hear everyone out there who says we have enough spider characters in the universe. But do we have enough punk characters in the universe? And that's the only argument I'm going to use. So moving on here, let's dive into EOP thing. You saw the rewards for the first time as we were kind of prepping a few days ago. What stands out to you? What are you excited about? I know we talked about it a little bit, but let everyone else know.
Yeah, so I think the rewards look fantastic. I didn't get to see the exploration rewards for the Eternity of Pain quest itself, and I think that also looks pretty good. I like that there's another 3-4 rank up gem, but it's really the 4-5 rank up gem. I am just so happy to see that in content in the first month of 2023, because we just had the banquet event, which is, you know, heavily rewarded spenders, which is totally fine because they're spending so much, but it's so nice to see a way for everyone else to get it through content, a rank 5 gem the month later, and I'm just I think you guys just did a great job with the rewards.
Very happy. I wish I could take credit for that myself. I can't. I will pass along the thank yous to people. We love to hear that positive feedback from people, and we do internally go and give it back to people. So in terms of earlier in the show, we had people asking, you know, basically, is there going to be more of this type of content for EOP acceptance? When we get an overwhelming positive response from people in the community, oftentimes, that encourages us to bring back more of that stuff. So we want to hear your positive feedback. We hear your notes. We know that not everything's perfect, but give us some of the good stuff that you love, and we can. We always try to cater that sort of stuff as well, right? Okay.
Sure.
What has been your approach to previous iterations of EOP, and then what specific preparations have you made getting ready here for acceptance?
So for the past iterations, you know, I like to try to get a solo on every single one of the fights for all of the objectives. And, you know, but with doing that, sometimes I can get it on my first try, second try. That's pretty rare. Usually it takes a few attempts. Sometimes it takes 10 minutes, sometimes it takes 30 minutes, sometimes it's taking an hour. And it's fun. I really like doing that. Unless it gets super duper hyper specific and it's just such a pain to solo, then I'll just use a revive because it's not a big deal if you have to use a revive. But I do try to get the solos for YouTube. And I do have a lot of fun trying to do that.
So I guess that's kind of where people are going to see the difference a little bit as well from live stream versus edited content. You're going to see the number of tries and the kind of learning process as you try to unlock all of the info you need. And then the YouTube, you're going to see here was the final product of that sort of stuff, right?
But also I try to tell people, like, listen, this was not my first attempt. It took me this many minutes, this many tries just to get this for you. Like, I
It is.
try to be fully transparent about
Yeah,
that.
it's important to kind of give that perspective as well. We see occasionally people in the forums reference YouTubers that can do content in X amount of minutes without any issues, and we try to remind them that it's probably not their first one. Don't worry. Like, it's a learning process
For
for
sure.
everyone, and I love that the community grows together. We kind of just touched on it a little bit, but EOP and MCOC in general has always been this kind of puzzle box. It's always kind of got these elements of these RPG approaches and difficult content and specific solutions to it in this kind of lock and key approach. It kind of makes this puzzle. So, how long does it typically take you to crack the code on content like EOP?
Yeah, it depends. This one, I was looking at all of the objectives, and I'm not even sure. Like, I haven't made any rank ups in preparation yet. I'm really just excited to jump in and really kind of get a taste of it for myself and kind of see who I need to rank, build my team. I was hoping that it was going to be five champions on our team, but it sounds like, I think it's already confirmed, only three champions, like the usual Eternity of Pain. So it's going to be even more challenging.
Yeah, I mean, there are those choice nodes, so
Yeah,
hopefully
that is interesting. I like that.
that'll give you a little bit more strategy to toy with. But yes, only the three, not the five. Sorry.
That's okay.
I
I was
think
just hoping, you
it's
know.
just a Canadian thing. We just apologize for stuff here.
Oh yeah, for sure.
Cool. I'm excited to have this in people's hands. I'm excited to have this in front of people. We got about 20 minutes until that time comes, and I know people are all very, very, very excited. Again, we're talking to Legacy Live right here. You can go to youtube.com/legacy to check out their content. Legs, are you going to be streaming this live right as soon as it goes?
Yeah, I just gotta make a thumbnail
You gotta
and then
get
I'll
the
be
thumbnail.
live.
You gotta
Yeah,
get the
I saw
thumbnail.
that Thanos art that you guys have looks incredible.
Thanks. Yeah, our art team is consistently knocking it out of the park. I would say it's one of the number one
Yeah.
compliments we get is
For
stage,
sure.
character design, all of these kind of artistic elements. It seems like positive.
100%. I only have one problem with the art team, and it's that I don't think they give us enough art. So I just want more.
Yeah,
It's
I
so
mean,
good.
I have the
Just more.
same problem with them. No, we have a relatively small art team. They all work very, very hard. And if we had more of them, we'd churn out more content. But we are glad to pass along the positive praise from a lot of people here. All
They
right.
always knock it out of the park.
Good to hear it. Good to hear it. I think we're going to move into our next segment here. We might wrap up with, if we get any good Q&A for Legacy, Legs, if you're cool with it, we might take some questions from the audience before we send you on your way. But
For
while we
sure.
give everyone an opportunity to potentially ask those questions, let's dive into our new segment. I mean, it's a completely new show. All of it's new. New segment either way, which we're going to call MCOC for Beginners. Every time we bring on a content creator, our intention is to have them teach us all something new about the game, something that we can all learn together. When I say MCOC for Beginners, I will not only be posing as that beginner, I will be the beginner. Again, my MCOC journey started a lot later than everyone else's here, and there's a lot to learn, and I've been learning. Legs, I've used some of your videos in the past to learn as well. Today,
So
we
how
are
long have you
going
been
to.
playing for now?
I started as a community manager in May, and I started interviewing sooner than that. So I started playing the game before that. MCOC has enough reach that when I went back to start the game, I'd already had an account. Like, I'd played it previously for a little while, I guess.
Oh, that's
So
cool.
it was not something I'd kept up with clearly. But coming back to it, I'm learning. So we approached Legacy and we said, hey, what is something that you think you excel at that you could teach someone who's a little bit less experienced at the game? Legs, what are you going to be teaching everybody right now?
Yeah, I'm just going to teach you how to play Human Torch, one of my favorite champs.
Human Torch. Now, again, a little more behind the scenes, Legacy said, it's easy. It'll take 5 minutes for me to teach you. And I said, it might take me 10 minutes to learn, though. So here we are. We've loaded up our squad. We've got the Fantastic Four and Doom. Just to be, you know, I just like, not, I'll be honest, it's not for the synergies. It's just we like things to be in order. we just like it that way. For anyone asking, I don't have Human Torch on my roster, so I will be learning this brand new. What's the first thing that I need to know, Legacy, moving into Human Torch here?
Okay, so with Human Torch, his ideal matchups are against Mystic Champions. And I saw that there's a Jane Foster next. So here on this fight, let's go ahead and activate the pre-fight ability.
Hold on, I was looking for Jane Foster. There we go. Yeah. I'm here.
Yeah, so for this Iron Man, let's go ahead and activate the pre-fight ability. And I just want you to go for medium, light, medium combos. Mm-hmm. And you can block his special attacks because they will give you Smolder.
Ooh, Smolder. All right. Let's dip our toes in here just a little bit. We are in Act 5, which, if for full transparency, I just started to make some progress into.
That's good.
Thanks. Throughout this process, Legs has been very encouraging.
You can also weave in some heavies if you want as well, just to raise that temperature up.
Okay.
That's perfect.
I mean...
Oh, yeah, he's just melting. Perfect. That's why Human Torch's pre-fight is very powerful. Some people even talked about nerfing it, but yeah, it's pretty good.
Did you guys see that? All right, okay. Let's move on here. Okay.
Yeah, and then so now against Jane Foster, every single time she hits your block, you're going to get temperature and smolder, and it's going to be even better than that fight.
Okay, I just also want people to be aware that that was a fluke. If I could do that twice in a row, I'd be amazed. So here we are again. All right, anything in particular that we want to change up this time?
No, pretty much the same thing. This matchup's even easier for Torch, so yeah, you're good.
I'm willing to purchase a Human Torch. If anyone's willing to trade it to me, that would be great. All right, Talk to me about our special bar here. What am I aiming to launch special-wise?
Yeah, so you can go for the special too. It applies two of your incinerate abilities and applies a nice little stun. And I guess it just kills her through the block. That works too.
I can't be stopped, apparently. I can't be stopped here. Let me take one step back. No trading system. That's not coming. That was a joke. I want to
make sure everyone knows.
It was dangerous territory to joke about it, and I accept that. That's my bad, everybody. Didn't want to get anyone too excited about that one. I know. I shouldn't. All right, moving along here. Walk me through, are there any nodes specifically that are going to enhance or be detrimental to Human Torch? Because I know Human Torch has fallen out of the Battlegrounds meta with the nodes that we have in there this season. What would it kind of be on the other side?
I've still been using Torch. You definitely do have to adjust your playstyle, though. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, with the current Battlegrounds meta, once you do 10 hits, you basically can't really hit them for 30 seconds. So what I like to do is just build up my temperature, do those 10 hits, and then just kind of wait and then use them again. And he actually does work. You just kind of got to shift how you play in some metas with Torch. But he's also still looks a little bugged with that 40 persistent charges.
I just noticed it as well. Hey, he's fixed in the...
he's at 80 now.
He's fixed in the hot patch coming out today or tomorrow. We've had some pretty good reports from the community that helps us kind of investigate that process a little bit more as well. So shout out to everybody who's been letting us know. Again, not just Human Torch, but a handful of other persistent values from other champs as well.
Ooh, so, okay. Try to charge up your heavy attack here.
Oh, I didn't do it.
Yeah, that's what typically with the specialty you do get a nice stun, so you can kind of charge.
That is a good point. I will remember that.
I was gonna say go for special three, but that, like, you just did a special two right before I was about to say it.
Yeah, just the
But
short delay from me and my coach has been detrimental, but that's okay. We'll revive here. We'll dive back in. So when situationally, when do I want to use like an SP3 over an SP2?
yeah, so special three is great in a matchup like this one here because you don't have that pre-fight ability to get those Nova Flames, and you don't have a Mystic opponent that easily allows you to get the into that mode. So special three is just going to instantly put you into flame on and apply a big Nova Flame to the opponent. So it's perfect in a matchup like this. That's not super ideal for Torch.
Okay, now we talked about this behind the scenes as we were setting up a little bit, and I think it's important to hear because I was under the impression that I should learn how to dex every special from every champion in the game. What's your kind of philosophy in that approach?
Yeah, if this was like 5 years ago when I started playing the game, I would say yeah, absolutely. But now there's like three times as many champions, so that's a lot of champions' abilities, first of all, to learn to evade, and second of all, not every single champion in the game can have their abilities fully evaded. So you definitely shouldn't try to evade every single champion, but yes, it is a good idea to try to learn as much as you can, for sure.
All right, let's dive into one more here. And let me ask you, when you're playing live on stream or for edited content, how does it differ from when you're playing kind of just in your own time?
I'm definitely goofing around more when I'm streaming.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, for
So you
sure.
don't feel
Just a lot more
necessarily that
goofing
you just
around.
have to be like on your game, right? You're trying to,
No,
well, I guess at that
definitely
point you're
not.
an entertainer, right? You're trying to keep people entertained. That
Yeah,
seems
only if I'm
important.
doing something like super serious, like a really intense Battlegrounds match or a
I
tournament
looked up.
match or something like that, you know. Other than that, I'm probably just goofing around, having a good time.
Okay, good. I think that we touched on it a bit. What sets you aside from other content creators? A personality is going to be a large part of that for a lot of people. People are coming back to see legs in action, you know?
Yeah, got that Canadian-ness, you know?
All the Canadian-ness. What? So we made sure to set you up with breakfast. Did you get Tim Hortons like a good Canadian?
No, there's this place close to my house that I got. It was really good though. Some bacon hash browns. It's delicious.
All right. Love to hear it. Legs, thanks so much for helping me and hopefully a handful of other people out there learn a little bit more about Human Torch.
Yeah.
I warned you ahead of time. I'm still learning. Also,
You're doing
multitasking is a
good.
little bit tough, but Legacy's been so encouraging. I appreciated that so much. Let's take
Yeah,
one
man.
question from the audience before we let you go here, Legs.
Sure.
From Samasam, Legacy, what champion rework would you like to see in 2023?
Ooh, that's a good one. I think Symbiote Spider-Man. I would really love to see him reworked. Spider-Man's my favorite character in all of Marvel, and the arcs when he isn't gets involved with any kind of the symbiotes are always my favorite Spider-Man stories. So the fact that Symbiote Spider-Man kind of sucks just has always bothered me. Yeah.
We'll run it up the chain. No promises at this
Okay.
point.
That's
But
encouraging.
thank you so much, Legs, for being our first ever guest to put a spotlight on from our content creator program. Again, anyone watching, please head over to youtube.com/legacy. Check out the channel. Drop a subscription over there, and Legacy is going to be live in just a matter of minutes here. We've got about 10 minutes until Eternity of Pain Acceptance goes live, and Legs is going to try their absolute best to take it on. Legacy, thank you so much for joining us, man. I appreciate you.
Thank you so much for having me. This was an absolute honor. Just, I can't say thank you enough.
Such a sweetheart. Thanks, buddy. Unbelievable getting to talk to the man, the myth, the legend, Legacy. Gang, we're getting close to the end here. We've got EOP acceptance on the horizon. I hope you all are excited for it as well. Before we kind of wrap up the show, I want to let you guys know that we're going to have our next live stream on February 3rd. Keep an eye on MCOC social media accounts for the specific time and details. We are hoping, again, to build out this schedule so that we're live once a month. Right now, we're kind of doing it by necessity. When do we need to communicate things to you? When do we have things that are exciting to share with you? But we would love to fall into a routine where once a month, potentially twice a month, we come together and hang out live on Twitch here to be able to interact with each and every one of you. And we see you guys here. We see you, James Wilson. We see you, I'm Newbie. Gutta Shark, Lags in chat. Thanks for popping back in to hang out here. And again, we want to do more like this. We want to know what you guys want. So please, please, please come hang out in the forums. Give us some feedback. Let us know. On February 3rd, we want to discuss and announce the winner of Summoner's Choice 2023. We think it's going to be an awesome time. It'll be the first time you get this information. This will be the grand reveal. We can talk to devs that helped through the process. We can talk to the people that organized the event in general, possibly talk about some of the design around Hercules and Quicksilver in the past. Again, the more of you there are here, the more content we are able to share here. So thank you to each and every one of you. Let's talk about the future just a little bit here. What are we trying to accomplish with these streams? What are some things that we have eagerness to layer in over time? We want to bring in some things like trivia and polls in chat. Should be pretty simple, pretty straightforward. I also want to highlight specific quotes and moments from our community with a little segment of quotable community moments. I think that would be a lot of fun as well. I think one of the things that will be most appealing to the most people here, we want to work towards installing Twitch drops on our channel, on Twitch as a platform. So we want to encourage you all to start your own Twitch channels, start your own content creation journey around MCOC. Twitch drops, for anyone who is unaware, we can set it on our side with a great feat of engineering that will need to come at a later time. So that essentially, the amount of time you watch a stream after it crosses a certain threshold, you can be granted an in-game item. We want to reward you all for creating content here and consuming content here on Twitch. But again, we need more people coming to hang out at these streams to prove to the powers that be up above that there is a case for this. So tell your friends, come hang out, bring them all, bring your pets. I don't think it counts towards viewership, but I want to see pictures of pets. That's it. So everybody, honestly, from the bottom of my heart, thank you for coming to support the first ever official MCOC live stream. This has been a long time coming. This has been in the works from Mike and the community team, even before I set foot in the building. So I know it's a long time coming and a big dream for a lot of people. We couldn't have done this alone either. We had a whole production team behind the scenes, so I want to give a big thanks to Mike, but also the production team here. We've got Rob, Fenton, James. We've also got Mickey. A big shout out to Kevin and Legacy for being our first ever guests. It's not easy being live on the internet, and Kevin, I would say, did a fantastic job. We knew Legacy would, but Kevin exceeded expectations. Just a good dude all the way around. We see you out here, K9 community. We are going to attempt to raid you. It is a large process on our end, but we're going to send everybody over to Canal K9, Brazilian MCOC content creator here with a Twitch raid. Everybody, again, thank you from the bottom of our hearts for being here, for supporting us, for coming together as a community. All of you summoners, I appreciate you. We will see you again February 3rd. Check social media accounts. Everybody, have a fantastic day.